ऐगिरि नंदिनी नंदित मेधिनी विश्व विनोदिनी नंदनु ते गिरिवर विंध्य शिरोधिनी वासिनी विष्णु विलासिनी जेष्णुनु ते
नमस्कार. It has been a while since I've been in this space. The last of the exposes that I have done was about a family or a girl that has been separated from her family from a church called Layman's Evangelical Fellowship, also called as LEF. Based on what we have done as a result of the exposes that we have done, there were some things that came out. First of all, the parents were worried that the daughter was missing and they didn't even know if she was alive or dead. The second thing that we came up was her child who was almost 7 years old. Is he still well? Is he with his mother? And of course, all of this, and the most important thing was to get to the bottom of why the daughter, or Elsie in this case, was on a run or still is on a run for almost 7 years now. Who is the one who's controlling her for all these years? So these were some questions and some worries that the family had. One of the things, as long as I have kept up with this case, one of the things that was very hard to prove was to implicate LEF's involvement in this girl's separation from both her parents and her husband, and also keeping her as a captive away from civil society. Because of the expose that we have done on behalf of LEF, Joshua Daniels' oldest daughter, Betty Daniel, has come out in public and has given has made a video with Elsie saying that they are lovingly taking care of Elsie. LEF people are lovingly taking care of Elsie. And that's exactly what we wanted, because we had to figure out who are these people who are keeping her. Of course, all the while we knew that LEF people, Lily Daniel, John Daniel, and all of them, Emmanuel Chakravarti, Parimala, these were the people who were keeping this girl as captive. But there was really no proof to that. But now, as a result of this expose, we have the proof. Now the Indian judicial system, the legal systems of the country will take care of this going forward. So I'm not going to talk about this more because it is sub judiciary now. And one of the tricks that LEF people played for a very long time is that, she's a major, so the parents have nothing to do with that, or the parents don't have any control over that. This has been their tactic from the time they established this organization. They separate children from their parents and then use the children any which way they like. And whenever the parents protest, the one big thing that they say is, your daughter is a major, your son is a major, so you have no right over them. And we know in our Indian society, in our Bharatiya culture, that is not how it works. We don't raise our children just to hand them over to people like this who are manipulating them, who are misusing them, who are abusing them, and using them for their own agendas. So now, the law of the land is going to take care of this. We have some legal actions lined up to get to the bottom of this. So I'm going to move on, but as a continuation of this, I had a more pressing question that I had. I wanted to find out, how is it that people like Mr. Gideon Garu, Grace Amma, and many others, how did they end up becoming pawns in the hands of these church leaders? What role did they play in kind of taking this much of control over the children of these people? What are those bigger narratives that we have in place? And of course, all of this leads to a huge population of Hindus coming to Christianity based on the narrative that they were looked down upon, there was discrimination, and these are generally the reasons that you see. We don't see very often stories of a person embarking on a journey to find out God, and then as part of that journey, he tried a Hindu God, then he tried a Muslim God, and now he's trying a Christian God, and that's how he came up with finding out that Christian God is a real God. You never hear that narrative. nor do you read a narrative, especially among the illiterates or the not so educated class of India, that they came upon Christianity because of their rigorous study. It's always some kind of a miracle that happened, or some kind of a discrimination narrative that they want to propagate. And of course, most Christians today, when you ask them about why they have this much hatred towards Hindu gods or Hindu temples, their one reason is that, oh, they were not treated equally in Hindu society. Now, I want to move on to a more in-depth and scholarly analysis of what is that thing that has pushed huge population of the Hindus at one point turn towards Christianity. And of course, we know this happened post the British rule. So something must have happened during the British rule to disengage a huge population of the Hindus from India, from the Hindu heritage, Hindu moorings, Hindu culture, anything to related to Hinduism. And we know that especially in Telugu states today, the higher populations of Christians are from Dalit backgrounds, both from scheduled caste and scheduled tribe backgrounds. Not even scheduled tribes that much, a lot of scheduled caste backgrounds. And the two major caste groups in scheduled caste today in Telugu states are the Madigas and the Malas. And there was like, it is no exaggerations to say that 85 to 90% of Christian population today is from these two caste backgrounds. So we have to understand, or we have to come to the bottom of what caused this mass migration of the once Hindu communities to move on to Christianity. And of course, the bigger question today, what is our problem? Why are we worried about these people taking up this religion? Okay, and I mean, it is a secular country. We allow people to take whichever religion they want, and that is how the Indian thought is, like, to each their own as far as the religion is concerned. But why is it that people like us come out like this and are trying to do what we are doing? What is our motive in this? What drives us? We all know that the people that have converted to Christianity from the Dalit backgrounds have been fed a narrative that they were never part of this wider Hindu ecosystem. They were told that they were somehow were kept away because they were from the so-called untouchable communities, and that is the reason they never had any spiritual heritage to begin with. And they were not allowed into the temples, they were not allowed into being part to take a major part in any spiritual traditions of the land. These are some narratives that they have, and I've heard this growing up, but only when I have started these exposes as a resistance to what I'm doing, as some kind of a rebuttal, I see a lot of people coming out and trying to find out what background I come from, what caste roots I have, and all of these things. And some of these people go as far as to abuse me now, because now they say that since I'm married to a Brahmin and I'm actually now being brainwashed by the Brahmins, or I'm co-opted by the Brahmin community to kind of now turn against the Christians and deny all these discrimination narratives. Now I have also become part of the group of persecuting these oppressed people. So these things came out, and I had to take a step back and say, you know what, I need to go to the bottom of where are these narratives coming from. Is it really true that a huge section of the so-called Dalit background people were oppressed, discriminated against? Is there any truth to that? If it was not there, who created this narrative, and who is benefiting from this narrative? And all of these big questions. As part of this inquiry, I have started doing some research, and I will do a lot of videos in addition to actually working on a book that is going to examine this in a more scholarly way. But in that series, as part of that series, I am based on what is happening in Telugu states today. One of the big concerns that we have in Telugu states today is that there is, especially in Andhra Pradesh, under the rule of Jagan Mohan Reddy, we see a huge uprisal, or a big number of temples being attacked, and temple properties being destroyed, like the temple chariots being destroyed, murtis being destroyed. Now, all of these actions are not just coincidences. This seems to be happening from a position of taking shelter with those who are in power, and then using that shelter to exhibit this kind of impunity and destroy the Hindu properties. Now, obviously, the people who are doing this should have deep hatred towards the Hindu culture or the Hindu temples or the traditions or anything related to Hinduism. How did they end up getting into this situation where they are driven by hate to destroy the temple properties? Okay, obviously, it is because they have imbibed a narrative, or they bought into this lie that the temple traditions, or what is happening in the temples, are, or what is being taught in the temples. You know that nothing is taught in the temples, but still there is a belief system that people who closely monitor these temples are also the authors of this discrimination stories. These are the people who, because of their powerful positions managing these temples, had the power to dictate that this person is not allowed, that person is not allowed into the temple. And obviously, they all of them point their fingers to the Brahmin community. So, converting to Christianity per se is not a big problem. They have freedom to do that. But this conversion is on account of feeling let down by the larger Hindu society. They don't see themselves as being equal partners in this Hindu tradition. They don't see themselves as being Bhagya Swamis of this great heritage. And in fact, they think that it is because of this Hindu tradition or Hindu thought that they have gotten this low status in the society. And so today, the temples or the temple traditions or whatever is happening in Hindu temples is somehow seen as the cause of their very oppression. Okay, so that narrative or that kind of brainwashing has caused, in my opinion, this hatred towards everything Hindu. I would like to give more insights into how caste equations in Telugu states are used by conversion missionary that work closely with politicians to mold the Christian psyche. What is that one big reason that people from Dalit backgrounds give for converting to Christianity? That reason is, of course, that they or their ancestors faced discrimination at the hands of Hindus from so-called higher castes. Now, there is no trophy for guessing here, as we all know that the Hindu that these Dalit Christians point to invariably is a Brahmin. They show him as the reason for them to walk away from Hinduism. To prove this point that all of this hate by Brahmins was based on some Hindu text, they all run to Manusmriti. Now, is there any evidence to this claim in history? Do we know of any Brahmins who carried out violent attacks on Dalits? Or are there any records of Brahmins instigating other higher caste Hindus to carry out physical attacks on Dalits? Well, I'm talking about attacks. I'm talking about attacks that involve cold-blooded murders of Dalits, raping of Dalit women in broad daylight, beating up of Dalits, destroying the houses and belongings of Dalits. When was the last time you read or heard about a person from Brahmin community beating up a Dalit person to death? When did you last hear news of a Brahmin young boy raping a Dalit woman to teach the Dalit families a lesson to stay within their limits? If you are honest for both my questions, your answer will be, I have not read any such news about these kinds of Brahmin atrocities. For the next set of questions, did you ever hear a Christian hate brigade who championed the cause of Dalits talk about atrocities done by Reddy, Kamma or Kapu landlords and state that as the reason for Dalits to leave Hindu fold? When did you last hear a long discussion on Christian channels discussing Reddy, Kamma or Kapu atrocities against Dalits and conclude that these kinds of atrocities are the reason for Dalit communities to turn to Christianity? Again, that answer will also be never. Please do not get me wrong. None of what I'm saying is to malign any caste group, but to throw light on how today the blame for the so-called caste hegemony is placed on Brahmins and make them culpable for crimes they have no part in. What I want to address here is the misplaced anger that gave birth to false narratives, which are created by those who are neither interested in the upliftment of Dalit communities, nor are interested in addressing the issue at hand, which in this case is to expose the real culprits of these crimes against Dalits. We know that today about 85 to 90% of all Christians in Telugu states come from Dalit background. And if you looked up the list of those who are brutally killed in Karam Chedu, we see that majority of those who were murdered so gruesomely were all not just Dalits, but they were Dalit Christians or Christians from Dalit backgrounds. In this case, they were from a community called Madiga community. Mariamma, Victoria, Yehoshua, Moshe, Yesu, Vandanam are some names that come up, and all of them were of course Christian names. And of course there were also other people like Muttaya, Sulochana and Ramesh, and we don't know if they were also Christians, but these were also some of the people who were killed. And who were the killers? They were people from Kamma community. For those of you who don't know, Karam Chedu massacre happened on July 17th, 1985. Exactly 2 years later, on July 15th of 1987, another massacre took place in Neerukonda near Mangalagiri in Guntur district. The perpetrators of this massacre were also from Kamma community, and six or so victims were from Mala community. Now, this massacre had such devastating effects that people from the Mala families permanently decided to move out of Neerukonda and are now believed to have relocated to Mangalagiri. These are two of the major massacres which took place during the tenure of N.T. Rama Rao, the first ever Kamma chief minister of the then combined Andhra Pradesh. The next big massacre of Dalits took place in the year 1991 in a place called Chunduru in Guntur district. This massacre happened on June 4th of 1991. Now again, majority of the victims were Christians, as can be seen from their names: Mattaya, Emmanuel, Issaku, Samsonu, Parshuddharav, or few of those murdered on that day. The chief minister of the state at that time was N. Janardhan Reddy. And again, it is no brainer that the perpetrators of these crimes were people from Reddy community, barring a few from Kapu community. This is not by any means a conclusive list of crimes against Dalits, or more specifically Dalits from Christian backgrounds. There are many more, but I refer to these massacres as they got more media coverage. In all these crimes involving Dalits, the perpetrators belong to mostly Kamma or Reddy communities. Once again, this is not to show any community of people in poor light, but to have an honest discussion, to bring to light the hypocrisy of those who, in the name of championing the cause of Dalits, attacked or continue to attack Brahmins to convert Dalits to Christianity. Why is it that conversion mafia shows a Brahmin as a boogeyman and depict him as the oppressor? If indeed caste-based oppression is the reason for conversion to Christianity, then shouldn't today's Christian leaders, especially Christian leaders from Dalit communities, talk about the more recent atrocities against Dalit Christians? There is not a single shred of evidence of a Brahmin carrying out any kind of physical attack against anyone, much less a Dalit. There is not one instance of Brahmins carrying out attacks on Dalits like that of what happened in Karamchedu, Chunduru or Neerukonda just in the recent past. Why is it that this Christian hate brigade never dare to talk about Reddy, Kamma or Kapu oppressions of Dalits that they saw happening right in front of their own eyes? Is it because Brahmins are defenseless and are easy targets? Or is it because this Christian hate brigade know that they will meet the same fate as that of Dalit Christians of Karamchedu, Neerukonda or Chunduru if they dare to open their mouths to talk about caste oppressions that Dalit Christians continue to face at the hands of Kammas and Reddys, who are now lording over them in their own churches? Or is it because the powers that be managed to turn a Brahmin into a common enemy to consolidate the votes of Dalits? We don't need to look far to find answers for the above questions, as we all know that employing anti-Brahmin propaganda is a time-tested method used to break away huge sections of Hindu Dalits from their ancestral roots, as a Brahmin somehow has become a face of all that is Hindu. So the easy recipe to break away and uproot and unhinge a Dalit Hindu from his ancestral roots is by depicting a Brahmin as an oppressor of worst kind. As we all can see, once unhinged, these Dalit Hindus become easy targets for conversion mafia. And if truth be told, if there is one group of people whose voting patterns are highly predictable, it is those that identify themselves as Christians, either openly or covertly. It is indeed mind-boggling as to how conversion mafia managed to unite so many warring factions under one banner by turning a Brahmin into a boogeyman who supposedly oppressed them and their ancestors for however many generations to make them all turn to one true living God, Jesus in this case. If one has the basic intelligence to connect the dots, then he or she will be able to see the big picture. The big picture of how projecting a Brahmin as a common enemy, the anti-Bharat forces have worked to break Dalits away from their larger Hindu families and have brought them all into the enemy camp to hold them as hostages under the close watch of draconian pastor ayahs and the Bible ammas. These pastor ayahs and Bible ammas, who enjoy the auspices of those who are politically in power, are the ones that propagate these narratives. Up until 1980s, Congress had complete monopoly ruling the Telugus through chief ministers hailing mostly from Reddy communities. Not sure how many of us know this. The first documented convert to Christianity was Thumma Hanumanta Reddy, and this conversion took place in the year 1715. What does that tell us? It tells us that a certain section of Reddys were in bed with conversion mafia for over 300 years. And is it any surprise that anti-Hindu Congress party chose Reddys over others to appoint them as chief ministers? There are enough murmurs in the grapevine that Kasu Brahmananda Reddy, Neelam Sanjeev Reddy, and even Kiran Kumar Reddy, the last CM of combined Andhra Pradesh, were all crypto-Christians. Not surprisingly, in Telugu states, the two power-hungry political groups that are at war since 80s are Kammas and Reddys. And both these groups know that today's electoral victory is guaranteed for those who can win the Dalits' votes as one big chunk. And an easy way to consolidate Dalit votes is by binding them in the brotherly Christian bondage. If it is hard to jog the memory of those who have trouble recollecting events from distant past, let's look at two snippets to give a visual of how the two warring groups in Andhra Pradesh are wooing Christians. We should not forget here again that 85 to 90% of the Christians are from Dalit backgrounds.
Bible కీర్తనల్ని ఎప్పటికప్పుడు మళ్ళా ఒకసారి నెమరు వేసుకుంటున్నాం. ఆ సందర్భంగా చూస్తే 23 కీర్తన 23 ఒకసారి చూసినప్పుడు యెహోవా నా కాపరి నాకు లేని కలుగదు.
అండ్ మెజారిటీ ఆఫ్ దీస్ దళిత్స్ హ్యావ్ అ స్టాండర్డ్ టెంప్లెట్ ఫర్ ద రీజన్ ఫర్ దేర్ కన్వర్షన్స్ అండ్ దే ఆల్ షో an imaginary Brahmin boogeyman as the reason for them to or their ancestors to leave to Christianity. This is where irony dies a million deaths. All of these Dalit Christians whom these warring faction leaders are trying to woo repeat like parrots what their pastors in churches told them about some imagined Brahmin patriarchy that oppress them to make them leave Hindu fold, while they sit at the feet of people from those landlord communities whose monstrous hate they recently experienced, which took the lives of their helpless brothers and sisters in places like Karamchedu, Neerukonda and Chunduru. The brainwashed Dalit Christians somehow have developed a short-term memory loss and fail to remember that Kamma and Reddy community landlords are the ones who not only exploited the poor landless Dalits all the while, but also massacred them when the very same Dalits did not submit to the political will of their masters. The aftermath of these massacres has resulted in legislation such as SC/ST Atrocity Prevention Act, and because of which now it is hard to beat people into submission. So the Reddy and Kamma aspirants who want to become chief ministers of Andhra Pradesh have come up with a brand new scheme to turn Dalits into pawns in their political chess game. This brand new scheme of enslaving Dalits is by using pastor ayahs and Bible ammas. And this is a foolproof one, as the pastor ayahs and Bible ammas do the heavy lifting to make sure that Dalits who have now walked into Christian concentration camps do not dare to escape the tyranny of the church. Because now the fear that they put is that if you leave the church, then you will burn in eternal hell. And as long as you're part of the church, the pastor can take care of these beloved sheep to ensure that all of them as one block can vote to the person whom the pastor asked them to vote for. To that one whose mother walks around with a big black book in her hand. Never mind that the widowed mother of the beloved CM of Andhra Pradesh has a big red bottu that she carefully adorns to keep the deracinated Hindus also in good humor. Without cracking a whip or shedding a drop of blood, the Dalits who were chased and beaten to death for not accepting the lordship of Kamma and Reddy landlords are now made to willingly submit to their masters, who enjoy the patronage of the person who is now in the CM seat. To elaborate more on this, I will use the example of a church called Layman's Evangelical Fellowship, also known as LEF. As I happen to have seen this church quite closely for over 40 years, I know many of these players by their names. I also know how they used caste politics to get to where they are today to establish themselves as pastors and evangelists. I will talk about the pecking order of these dubious pastors and evangelists who have used the caste hierarchies to exploit the poor and the gullible Christians who mostly hail from Dalit backgrounds. And for those LEF people who are listening to this, I don't know how many of you know this, but your beloved leader, Joshua Daniel, came from a Dalit background. They lie through their teeth and say that they came from some Pujari community, which is a big lie. He was either a Madiga person or a Mala person. And there was another lie that is propagated among LEF people that Mrs. Daniel and Daniel's wife, Divanamma Daniel, was from some Reddy community. That also is a big lie. Both of them have taken on this role of being saviors to Dalit Christians or Dalits who are oppressed by Hinduism to bring them all into Christian fold. And I will elaborate more on how they built an empire with these narrative and left the church or LEF or whatever you want to call it today into the hands of monsters like Peter Paul, Suresh Marcus, Satyam, Damodar Rao, and surprisingly, what caste group do they all belong to? They're all Kammas. And I'll talk about this more in detail in my next episode. Thank you so much. Stay tuned.